It's been 50 years since the first Surgeon General's report on smoking. I was a little kid at the time when it came out, but I remember it really well, even though I was small, because I remember my father's reaction to the report. Like many smokers at the time, he was stunned to learn that the habit he enjoyed could be lethal and could eventually lead to lung cancer. He quit smoking as a result of reading that report, and so did many other people. Things are different now, of course. Many fewer people smoke. And it's no longer permissible to smoke in public places like restaurants and airplanes. But smoking remains the number one preventable cause of death, not only worldwide, but just here in the United States. In the United States alone, the equivalent of the entire population of the city of Atlanta dies every year as a result of cigarette smoking. And perhaps even more disturbing, the equivalent of the undergraduate population here at University Park dies every year as a result of breathing in passive smoke. These are non-smokers dying as a result of other people smoking. And think about that. It's not just the freshmen, not just the sophomores, and not just one year, but every year, the equivalent of the entire undergraduate population here. Smoking is a really serious public health hazard, and it's everyone's problem, not just a problem for smokers. A lot of research has shown that most smokers, the majority of smokers, would like to quit. Nicotine is a very addictive substance, and it's really difficult to quit smoking. Fortunately, there are behavioral interventions that have been developed to help people quit smoking. A behavioral intervention is an evidence-based program aimed at helping people change a particular focused health behavior. Now, human behavior is complex, smoking is a complex behavior, and so behavioral interventions for smoking cessation are complex too. They're usually made up of a number of different components. So, for example, a behavioral intervention for smoking cessation might include pre-cessation counseling to help an individual get prepared to quit, supervised practice quit attempts so that the person will have a sense of what it's like when they quit smoking for real, counseling offered across the entire quitting process, in person and possibly over the phone to help the person stay on track, and a pharmaceutical, such as nicotine replacement therapy. And many behavioral interventions include pharmaceuticals. In the year 2000, the nation set goals for the year 2010, health goals. And the goal they set for adult smoking was to reduce the prevalence of adult smoking from the level it was at that time in 2000, which was about 24%, to 12%. When those goals were reviewed in 2010, we found that we had not met that goal. At that time, in 2010, the prevalence of adult smoking had dropped only about 3 percentage points to 21%. So when new goals were set for the year 2020, the same goal was set, to reduce the prevalence of adult smoking to 12%. Now let's think about that for a second. We did not make that goal for the year 2010. What are our chances of making it for the year 2020? I'm optimistic that we can make that goal, but in order to make it, we need more effective behavioral interventions for smoking cessation. And I think the only way we can get those much more effective behavioral interventions for smoking cessation is to develop behavioral interventions in a radically different way from the way we've been doing it up until now. Let's take another goal that was set by the American people, one that we met much more successfully than the smoking cessation goal. In 1961, President John F. Kennedy challenged the nation to put humans on the moon and bring them back safely by the end of the decade. We met that goal resoundingly. In 1969, two humans walked on the moon and came home to tell us about it. Let's take a look at how NASA approached that goal and compare it with the way behavioral science is going about developing smoking cessation interventions. NASA knew that it had to engineer a spacecraft that could carry people to the moon and bring them back. Now, what do I mean by engineer a spacecraft? They knew that they had to work programmatically and systematically toward this goal of landing humans on the moon and bringing them back successfully. They started with a set of components that were candidates for inclusion in a prototype spacecraft. They examined empirically the performance of each of those components and also looked at how they performed with other components that they had to work with. Any component that wasn't working properly or didn't work well with other components was either revised or removed or replaced. Only when they had a set of components where they understood the operation of the components really well, they were confident that each component was making an important contribution, doing what it was supposed to do, only then would they build a prototype rocket and launch it. Did any of those prototype spacecraft fail? Yes, a number of them failed. But here's the important thing. Because of the way they worked, every spacecraft was better than the one before. Every prototype was better than the one that had preceded it. And they worked carefully and incrementally until eventually they had a spacecraft that they were confident could bring astronauts to the moon. Let's compare that with the way behavioral science is operating today to develop smoking cessation interventions. I said before that smoking cessation interventions are made up of a number of different components. So the starting point is a set of components that are candidates for inclusion in the behavioral intervention. But instead of empirically examining the performance of each of these components, weeding through the ones that don't work, selecting the ones that do work, replacing the ones that don't work, behavioral science today, the state of the art, is to go directly from that list of components, put together a behavioral intervention and test it in a randomized clinical trial. That clinical trial is the equivalent of NASA's rocket launch. What's the problem with that approach? The problem is that if in the clinical trial it turns out that the intervention worked, that's great, but we don't know why it worked. If it turns out that the intervention failed, it didn't work, we don't know why it didn't work. And either way, we're left without knowing what are the steps we need to take so that the next intervention we develop is better than this one. In the 50 years since the Surgeon General's report, a lot of time, money, and expertise has gone into development of behavioral interventions for smoking cessation. And there are a lot of different interventions out there. And yet, we have not been working programmatically toward better and better and better behavioral interventions. This essentially trial and error approach, where a set of components is immediately assembled and tried out in a clinical trial, is not getting us toward better and better and better behavioral interventions. Instead, what if we took a page from NASA's book? What if we started using engineering approaches to develop behavioral interventions? I'm involved in a project to do exactly this. This project is funded by the National Cancer Institute, and it's a collaborative endeavor involving scientists from the University of Wisconsin, the University of Illinois at Chicago, and Penn State. We've assembled a set of 15 components that are candidates for inclusion in a smoking cessation intervention. We're examining the performance of these 15 components in a set of 3 randomized experiments. These experiments are taking place in ordinary healthcare settings where you might go if you needed a routine doctor visit. But each of these healthcare settings uses the electronic health record. So if an individual is a smoker, that popped up at check-in and they were invited to take part in the experiments. The experiments are over, we've collected the data, we're in the process of analyzing it now. The data will tell us which of the components is working and which are not working. And based on that, we'll be able to engineer a behavioral intervention. An example of the kind of decision we'll be making based on the data is we'll be able to tell whether a longer or shorter duration of nicotine replacement is better. Our goal is to engineer a highly effective behavioral intervention that also costs a reasonable amount to implement, because we believe it's important that the intervention be not only highly effective, but also practical to implement. Our hope is that after we've developed this behavioral intervention, the work of others and possibly our future work will develop another new intervention that is more effective, or perhaps equally effective, but less costly, or better in some other incremental way. The idea is just to keep getting better and better and better. Is it feasible to take this engineering approach to development of behavioral interventions? Yes, it's completely feasible. This engineering approach does not cost any more than today's trial and error approach. The field of engineering has developed a lot of very efficient approaches to experimentation. Of course, experimentation in engineering is different from experimentation that involves human subjects, but a number of scientists, myself included, are working on ways of adapting approaches that are in wide use in engineering for use in the behavioral sciences. Imagine if we engineered behavioral interventions. The approach I'm talking about today can be used not just for smoking cessation, but for behavioral interventions for lots of other areas. Treatment of alcohol abuse, treatment of drug abuse, treatment of obesity, helping people to comply better with chronic disease regimens, such as regimens for diabetes and HIV, or any other area of health behavior that you can imagine this approach could be used for. If we engineer behavioral interventions over time, they will systematically and incrementally become not only more effective, but more efficient, more cost-effective, and just more practical so that they can reach more people. Can we meet the goal of reducing the prevalence of adult smoking to 12% by the year 2020, or even go further? I think we can if we take a page from NASA's book and engineer behavioral interventions. Thank you.